That helps us scan the chat and find questions. Or you can unmute yourself, ask your question, and then mute yourself again. DeAnn, who is our featured speaker tonight, or today, or this morning, wherever you happen to be, has taught calligraphy and related art forms in the Los Angeles area for nearly 40 years. She specializes in historical writing for movie and television props and has created this lecture based on her experiences working with the Hollywood movie industry. I was lucky enough to see this lecture in 2017 at the Letterworks International Calligraphy Conference in Utah. It was in a beautiful, historical theater. DeAnn was magnified a bazillion times up on the giant screen. It was really wonderful. So I can tell you from my experience seeing it before that this is a great treat to see DeAnn in her, what's the right word, milieu?
Maybe.
Okay. Raul, if you would spotlight DeAnn, she can start her lecture.
We've taken 3 days in our tech checks and we're going to do the best we can. So I know we're all calligraphers and we excel at that, but we're going to really try to do our best at the computer stuff. Welcome, all of my friends. I'm so excited to see you all, and I can't see you. I was actually looking forward to seeing all of you in the little thumbnails, but I apparently am not going to be able to do that. But I welcome each and every one of you because, you know, that is the highlight of my life. And I love, love, love doing calligraphy, but I love even more teaching it to my friends. And anyone who knows me knows that I enjoy telling a story. If you get around me, I'll say, let me tell you this story. And then you're stuck with me for a few minutes while I tell you this story. And hopefully you'll enjoy that story.
If you want to live a more empowered life, therapy can get you there.
There's somebody that's not...
Excuse me, could everyone mute their microphones, please?
Okay. So anyway, I do enjoy telling you a story. And all these stories have been fun for me. And really, it's been because I just live in Los Angeles. And in West LA, between Culver City and Venice, and in Culver City and Venice, which is right in the middle of all of the movie studios. So I just am convenient to all of the industry, really. So I want to take you on a little adventure and tell you how it happened to me. And so I welcome all my friends and all of you that are potential friends. And we're going to see if I can share my screen as I've rehearsed it a million times. Let's see what happens. Okay. Up here. We're going to press play. We're going to press view.
You want to click on play?
Yes, I do want to do that. Indeed, I do. First, I want this to move. And then, okay. So Hollywood, if I had the music, the fanfare Hollywood, I would play that. And I have to pinch myself sometimes because I have a couple of students who are in the Hollywood production industry. I just came home in October from this big affair that they have every other year at the Beverly Hilton Hotel. And there's every person you can imagine that's in the music industry. And right here is Smokey Robinson, and right here is Quincy Jones. I'm not kidding. And here I am. DeAnn from a little town in Utah. I mean, I've lived in Los Angeles much longer than I ever lived in Utah, but I'm just this little kid from Utah. Well, Utah and Idaho. But here I'm rubbing elbows with Quincy Jones, Smokey Robinson, and all these people from the Berry Gordy, I mean. And I'm all of a sudden, they tell me, go to the front door and you be the greeter. Me, I'm the greeter at the front door, and I tell them to go to the VIP section or go to the regular section. Who am I to tell, you know, the guy, Pinocchio or what his name is from KTLA and Channel 7 Entertainment, and I get to decide if he goes to the VIP or not. And oh my God, I'm just pinching myself sometimes. And then I get to do that. And then that's just because I've written the place cards, because Mrs. Barbara Davis is a friend of a friend of mine. And then I got to go to Muhammad Ali's birthday party, you know, when he was alive. And I was sitting in seats right beside everybody who's anybody. And I'm just like, wow. And again, it has to do because I'm a calligraphy teacher, and one of the students is the producer of that birthday party. And she's become a friend all these many years. So, you know, so I get to do those kind of parties and things because of that. Then let me tell you a little bit about just me. Here we are. Now, I don't have two things going on, so there's a reverberation going on. I don't know, Nancy or Raul, if you hear that. One of my dearest students has a Academy Award, so she lent it to me so I could take a picture with it. And my other friend had a tiara, so I could borrow that from the first coronation of Elizabeth II. And then, of course, we all know how wonderful the second coronation was. The coronation just this past weekend of Charles with Tim Node and Ewan Clayton. Oh, my goodness, all the wonderful calligraphy that came from that. I'm so proud of them. But I don't have a tiara from that one. So I'm tiara-less, but I have my pearls. And they don't give an Oscar for calligraphy in the movies, so I just had to borrow one. So this is my studio, designing letters here in Mar Vista. And I have a big, beautiful patio that we can have classes in our beautiful Southern California weather out here. And my lovely little dog, who's no longer with us, Rooney, but he's in my heart always. And there's my studio and my beautiful friends that are in there having class. When we can't have it outside, we can have it inside. And so it's a beautiful place to have classes here. But here are some of the DVDs that are the movies that I've worked on. And we'll back in the 80s, someone asked me if I would do some cards for Tom Cruise. And he has a charity, let's see, I guess you call it that, an organization where they give reading and literacy to people with that have a hard, kids that have a hard time learning to read. And it's called HELP, H-E-L-P. And that's Hollywood Education and Literacy Project. So if you want to give a present to Tom Cruise or one of his family members, then what are you going to give him? You know, so they would donate money to his organization. And then I would make a card for that, for Tom, and sign their name. So after a little while though, I mean, you have to get better and bigger and better and bigger. And I did that for about 10 years. And then Tom, if he wanted to give a present to, let's say, John Travolta or Steven Spielberg, he would do the same thing and I would make a card for them. So boy, some of those cards were getting pretty elaborate over the years. And so I did that for a long time. And his sister called one time and said what a great job she thought I was doing and that they really appreciated it. And he was very, very kind. I never talked to him, but the organization, the person who came and got the cards and stuff, she said they really loved him and that they were really, that he was very appreciative and he was very kind. And then hopefully she's watching, but one of my students, Barbara Beck, my dear, dear friend, her nephew was producing this movie and needed some pages done. And she thought that it was above her pay grade. And so she came to me and asked me if I would do it. Now, it's a devil worship movie, you know, it's like, oh my goodness. Well, I have to say, you know, anything that has to do with devil stuff is really good for calligraphers because they need it to be gothic and all kinds of different letter forms in it. So this was, they said, the long-awaited sequel, sometimes they come back again. So watch this.
None Solomon Dominatus Daemonum Est.
Had not Solomon dominion over demons? No doubt he tried. The rewards are possibly tempting.
Gather all the pieces of the body together, reanimate them. Reserve the heart, for the foe's body should be consumed by his enemy before the first dawn.
Okay. Did you notice something wrong there?
Pieces was misspelled.
Isn't that awful? Have you ever done that before? Oh my God. Now, I never saw this in the movie, so I think it just went straight to video. And I remember I was on vacation. I went back to Utah and I had to go to Blockbuster to rent it. And I had everybody gathered around and put it in the VCR, and we played that, and there it is up on the screen, and I misspelled pieces right for God and everyone to see. Oh my God, I was so embarrassed. Right in the middle of the movie, I was just humiliated. But there it is. What are you gonna do? It's totally misspelled, right? Right there in front of God and everyone. Oh my hell, I can't go back and change it. So have you all done something like that? It didn't even dawn on me. I probably
there were no dictionaries in the medieval times. So.
Yeah, no dictionaries. Oh my God. Well, there we go. So I just that really sent me. But I thought, you know, after a while, I thought, well, anybody who's watching this kind of movie probably can't spell anyway. So I just had to let that go. But did you also notice that that's Alex P. Keaton's dad in Family Ties? So, you know, and it was the first movie that Hilary Swank was in. So, you know, it wasn't that bad. But it's also really big pages, and they already had the illustrations on them, and they were, you know, pretty graphic and stuff. So, but they didn't give me any text. I have to make all that stuff up, and that's pretty much the same thing even now. They never give me text. I have to make it up, or I have to research it myself. So he read this text. I probably should have gotten credit and pay for being a writer, because he read this and he read a whole bunch of stuff that I had written. And I had gone to the library and gotten books on the occult. And either I made it up or I found it in books and put it down on all these pages. There were four very large pages. And, you know, now that I look at this, I haven't seen this in a long time, really. And I'm really impressed with myself, because this was back in the 90s, I think 95. But let's look further. Let's look at some more.
Commingle the blood and sacrifice the girl in her 18th year. Let life leave her body at midnight and eat her still beating heart. Thus assuming the power of the beast. Thus, green, unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon. The mouth beast. Prophet may sever a digit to keep the latch closed. Slicing flesh and spilling blood on the circle, desecrating the beast, sending it back from whence it came.
Oh, pretty scary, huh? That's, they're after Hilary Swank on her 18th birthday. Yeah, so it's pretty scary. And let's see. Yeah, so with that one, I really didn't get paid very much. They didn't have much of a budget, but I did it anyway. And from that, someone from that set recommended me for another job. So I was able to get this job. And this one was at the Culver Studios, which is just a mile down the street from me. And it's with Denzel Washington and John Goodman. This was a scary one, I have to say. This wasn't just, you know, like people drinking blood kind of stuff. This is like where the devil's getting into you and stuff. And the when I went over to the studio and the art director's putting little angel stickers on everything because he was superstitious. I'm not very superstitious, but ever since seeing The Exorcist, I'm really scared of that kind of stuff, you know, and it's like, oh, that's kind of scary. But I did have a script. He gave me the script and we're going through it. And again, they don't tell you exactly what to do. You have to use your own imagination and make stuff up. So the cool stuff about this is they wanted me to come up with documents that looked like a character who's trying to vanquish this ghost, this not ghost, but devil, who is going from character to character. And so I went up to the American Jewish University that's up in Bel Air. We used to have our meetings, our calligraphy meetings up there. And so I was familiar with the campus. And I actually found a book that had incantations in it to vanquish the devil. Come on, how lucky was that? But I also wanted this to be believable enough. So if there's somebody in the audience who could read Aramaic, which there are people who read Aramaic, that they would be able to, you know, decipher it a little bit. So I tea-stained pergamonata paper and used a speedball bee nib, like a B5 nib, and traced it. Now, when you make any documents for any kind of movie props, you have to make at a minimum two, but most of the time three to five, and they have to be exactly alike. So generally I'll make one and then it has to get approved. And once it gets approved, then you have to make duplicates. So it has to be, so I put it on the light table and then trace it. So you have to do it in a way that you can trace it, somehow duplicate it. And so like with this one back and forth, this one, I put the paper, like that is real papyrus. And the paper on the right is some paper that I got years and years. Those of you in LA, there was a paper store, not McManus and Morgan, but another paper store. And they had really, really old paper. So that paper is practically 100 years old. And I still do this now. I make sure, because when they hold the paper up, that it's got like a laid pattern in it. And not just, you know, I don't want them to hold the paper up and it says Classic Crest on it, for instance, because then the audience is going to see it says Classic Crest. Well, that's not old paper. You know, I want it to look authentic. So I make sure, you know, or if it's going to be class, you know, a wove surface or something. So I really make sure that it's very authentic. And then I copy them onto, you know, because you can copy onto text wove and papyrus. I copied onto that, but you have to make four. I think I made four copies of everything. And then they were very, very, very pleased with what I came up on this. And so I did talk my daughter into going when the movie came out. So we went to the theater where we're waiting, and it's really scary. I don't know if any of you have seen this movie. It's a really good movie. It really is very good, very scary. And it got to the part where I knew that the documents were going to be, and they weren't there. They were edited out. There I sat through that movie and they weren't there. They got edited out. So that was my first taste of finding out that all the work that you do and all the money that they spend on different things can very easily get edited out. And I also found out that there's like times where like an actor or an actress will be in a movie and their whole part gets edited out. So you can never be sure that all the work that you put into something will even show up in it. As I found out with a lot of the stuff that I've done, that they don't show up in it. So, but I did the work and got paid for it. And that's the end of that, but it was fun. And then here's a few more. Buffy used to shoot just up the street in Santa Monica. And I kept thinking, you know, that's a devil show. I'm really surprised I haven't gotten anything from that. And finally, before they quit that show, I got a few things from them, but nothing devilish or anything. It was just handwriting. A lot of stuff is certificates that they just put up on the wall to show, like, you know, that person went to universities and stuff. And that's Tom Hanks, the From Earth to the Moon. I get a lot of those. Since I worked for the county doing scrolls, those are easy enough to do. If These Walls Could Talk, I did various things, you know, just props and stuff for that one too. And then Charmed, that one came along. And I think I got that again from somebody who saw that I had done the Fallen props. And I think all of you have probably seen this on TV. I think it ran for like 5 years or something on TV. So I just did the book, the title page of it. And then every once in a while, if the mother wanted to talk to him, the handwriting of the mother. So I was the mother's handwriting. But here's the title page.
Shadows.
I just get a kick out of it every time I see that because, you know, I get to make that up on my own. You know, they don't art direct that or anything. And, you know, if you look at any, I took those patterns right out of an illuminated manuscript how-to book that probably 90% of you guys have. If you look at that closely, you'll see which book I took that pattern out of. I still get a real kick out of it. There's people out there in the world who duplicate that book. So they've stopped on video every single page in that book, and then they've duplicated it. And they contact me all the time. Did you do that page? Did you do that page? Did you? All of them are really ugly. The other pages that are in the book, I haven't done any of the other pages, only the mother's handwriting. But they should have had calligraphers work on it, but they didn't. They just had, I don't know, somebody do them, but they're really ugly. Did you have a question?
Excuse me, Dan, this is Raul. Did you want to resume the slideshow? The screen is black.
Uh-huh, it'll go. Okay, so the next one is King of California. Has anybody seen this movie? Well, you know, I did the artwork for it and then I never saw it. You really have to look for it, but this is really worth looking for. It's Evan Rachel Wood and Michael Douglas. And the prop master came and said he needed to have a document that looks like it's 16th century Spanish, like the Spanish conquistadors had come to California and buried not a treasure map, but some kind of letter that described where they had buried treasure. So Michael Douglas had just come out of a mental institution and acquired this letter. And so he had left his daughter home alone. She was a teenager. And now he's gonna find, you know, the daughter and he and his cohorts are gonna find this buried treasure. And the buried treasure, if they're not wrong, is in Santa Clarita, under where they've just built a new Costco. And X marks the spot right under large appliances where there's washing machines and, you know, dryers. And so they're, when the store closes, they're digging underneath the washing machines at this Costco in Santa Clarita. It is so funny, but it's my document that I make. And I decided to do it in like Spanish, Gothic cursive. And it looked great, you know, and I made it look old, and it was on some probably Arches text wove, and I usually either tea stain it or airbrush it and make it really look old, and you fold it all up and you sand it, and but again, it didn't make it into the movie either. So I mean, I had to really work hard to find a DVD of this, and then it didn't show up in the movie either. But if you get a chance, find this movie, because it's really cute. It's a good one. But my piece didn't show up in it. Then the good one. This one, I worked a whole year on, and it was a lot of fun, and I got a lot of work on this one. So it's National Treasure: Book of Secrets. It's the sequel to National Treasure. So the same prop master came to me after King of California and said, had I seen the first one? And I hadn't. So I saw it on DVD. And then he started with, He started with the John Wilkes Booth diary. And I started to practice handwriting of John Wilkes Booth. And he said he wanted everything to be as authentic as possible. And so what I did is I practiced, and then Xeroxed John Wilkes Booth. I had a real facsimile of his writing from, they had gotten from like the Library of Congress, and then put it on acetate, and then put that as an overlay on top of my writing, so I could get my writing as close as possible in tone. Like nobody's gonna know if mine is exactly like his, just in tone, his writing. And then with all the presidents, for the president's book. So I'd take each one of the presidents, I don't know, I think there were 10 or 15 of the presidents, and duplicate their writing. And, you know, again, when everything's all said and done, you only see a fraction of what we actually put into it. So here's a little bit of the John Wilkes Booth diary. And I ended up making 100 of the John Wilkes Booth diary. And we burn them and burn them and burn them. I'll tell you a little bit more about that.
Are you Thomas Gates?
Yes.
We got something that we'd like you to take a look at. I hear you're quite good with puzzles and riddles.
It's a coded message. It's a Playfair cipher.
Can you decode it?
A cipher is impossible to decode without the key.
I believe what you need is right there.
Take some time.
Go on. I'll take your diary. I'll meet up with you later.
Oh. See? It's a treasure map.
I'd much appreciate it if you finished deciphering that code now.
You're wrong about that. The war has only just begun.
So each time they rehearse that, and if the camera's looking at this one and then the camera's looking this way, that's another shot. So that's another diary, you know? And each time they throw it into the fire, it's burned up. So it was time and time and time again. They actually used up every single one of those books that I did. I did 100, like I said. The guy who actually made the books is a guy in New Hampshire who does a lot of props for a lot of movies. But so it's incredible how they do those. I was right outside when they were in the huge soundstage. The soundstage is like the size of 2 football fields. It's just a huge, huge covered football fields. And then the little set that they're in is like a little teeny room. And I'm just outside of where they're filming this. And I'm listening to this go on. And each time they do a shot, and that little kid, you know, says, "Dad," and with all that emotion, I was so impressed that he could do that. You know, it's like the first time he's not just saying lines, he really is acting. And it was the first time I'd really understood how even a little kid, he was really crying. And then they take him by the hand and take him back to his tutor, you know, and wow, it was really impressive. But like the pencil that he had, I sharpened the pencil with a knife to make sure that it looked like an old pencil, like it's not sharpened with a pencil sharpener. And it was fun interacting with those two guys. You know, I said to him, "Well, you know, now I'm the guy who's John Wilkes Booth. I'm the one who writes your signature. So if somebody wants your autograph, you're going to have me sign your autograph for you." But he throws it into the fire and the other guy pulls it out of the fire. But that's not really the guy who pulls it out of the fire. Like 4 days later, another guy is pulling it out of the fire with asbestos and all this other stuff. And I'm watching them do these shots. And what I had done is taken individual pages, and I put 77 glue on the back of it, exactly where I wanted it to burn, and sprayed it. I masked it and put 77 glue because that's very flammable. And so that when it went into the fire, that part would burn really fast. And then they gave me some of this liquid retardant that I brushed on where I don't want it to burn. So that when that went into the fire, you could see it burn, but they needed it. And I'll show you in a second here where, there's parts that you needed to be able to read after it burned. And that's how I did it, is with the 77 glue and then with this retardant. So you'll see how that happened. Let's see the next one. So there's the pencil, you know, and it needed to look really raggedy, you know. And see, so the Surratt Copier, and when they threw it into the fire, then I needed it to burn very specifically.
Ladies and gentlemen, why I present to you one of the missing pages from the infamous diary of John Wilkes Booth, with the name Thomas Gates written on a list, along with all the other killers. And
Latin?
When Booth was a student of Latin, he shouted, "Sic semper tyrannis," after he shot Lincoln.
Thus always the tyrants, we know.
Surratt copier, military supplies. Mary Surratt was convicted and hanged for supplying Booth with a rifle and field glasses.
Thomas Gates.
So it needed to say Thomas Gates artifact. So, you know, those parts couldn't burn. So when the guy got it out of the fire, it needed to, that part needed to stay. So it worked really good too. So I was really happy with that.
You don't know Benjamin.
Perhaps not.
Now I'm right outside.
I have this.
Of the wall from this.
I went from Queen Victoria to the Confederate General Albert. Make.
Means a dear old queen was partial to the Confederate cause. This has been handed down by my family for 140 years. Contains a vital piece of information, the final clue, as it were. Of course, this piece of information is worthless without your translation of the planks. It's ironic, isn't it? This all began with the burning of pages. Now it ends with the burning of this. The final clues, making me the only one who can find Sewell. Get your coat.
So now again, this is another little set that's in this huge soundstage. Okay, so Raul, can you spotlight me? Okay, so again, I want you to see, to get this setting. This huge soundstage is black when the lights are out. And when I got there, all they had was, I needed a desk because I'm making those letters that Ed Harris just burned. And they needed 60 of those letters because he's burning them as fast as I can write them. Now I have an original and I brought my light table and I'm tracing them, but you know, it's a long letter and then it has to be addressed and then I folded it and put a wax stamp. My wax I used was Ward Dunham's wax and then it's so funny, they didn't like any of the stamps. Not like it really mattered. Nobody can see what the stamp was, but we're looking around thinking what kind of stamp, you know, a seal to put into the wax. And one of the prop guys goes, oh, look, I happen to have this ancient Roman coin in my purse. An ancient Roman coin in my purse. I just happened to have, what? So he has this ancient Roman coin in his purse and we hot glued it to a golf tee. So I was using that as the wax seal and I'm writing these as fast as I can. And then Ed Harris is burning them. And again, it's on this really, really old, it might have been Bodleian paper, and he's burning it. And so I'm just outside of that wall, and the soundstage is black. And the director is just inside with the actors. And, you know, there's other craftsmen and people working around, but you have to be silent when the filming is going on. So this is how it, well, but I'm writing. So I've got my light table here and the prop guys had just put two sawhorses and a door for me to write at and a chair. And they couldn't find just a little lamp for me. The only thing they could find was one of those great big spotlights, you know, a huge spotlight that's this big. And I'm going, you know, that's a little overkill, don't you think? But that's all they had. So this football field place that's just black, except for the set that's, but it's enclosed. I'm over here with this huge spotlight on me. And so I'm writing and writing, just, you know, doing my job, getting it done so I can stay ahead of the actors that's filming. And John Turteltaub, who's the director, this is how it goes. He's ready and he says, quiet on the set. And then he's got two other people way over here that goes quiet on the set. And the other one goes quiet. And then he says, action, action, action. And so, you know, this has been going on all day, no problem. So I'm just writing, minding my own business. And he goes, quiet on the set, quiet, quiet. And my phone rang. And of course, it's not just sitting up here on the table. It's in my purse. So I'm fiddling, trying to get to it. Now I've got this huge spotlight on me. There's no doubt that it's me because this huge spotlight is right on me. It, my face is probably as red as a beet. And I'm fiddling, trying to get to this dang phone, trying to turn it off. I get it turned off. And all I can do is sit here like this. And you hear the director go, cut. Cut, cut. And then everybody's looking at me, and then he goes, are we ready? I'm going, yeah. And then it's quiet on the set, quiet, quiet, action. And then it's like, oh my God. So it's, you know, one lesson to learn is turn your phone off, you know, like that's one big lesson I learned. So let's check our phones and see if they're off. That was so embarrassing. So my big spotlight, I'll never forget that one. So you can unspotlight me now. But that was my horrible experience. But Ed Harris did tell the prop guy, do you want to take me out there and introduce me to the person who's making all of these letters that's being burned up here? So I did get a picture of me and Ed Harris. He was very kind, but you know, the very second that he got out there, they're saying, Mr. Harris, on the set, on the set. This was the one that I spent the most time on the set, though. Even at the very last, like I started in maybe January and way, way back in like October or something. I was still fixing it. But I remember, let's see if that's, yeah, watch this part here.
So would you like to share your screen, please? DeAnn, you need to share your screen.
Oh, let me stop. Oh, I need to go back and share my screen. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, bear with me.
And if this is like a stretch.
Come on. I can't get that to come. Oh, I know, I did this before. Okay.
All Are you okay? Can you see the share screen button?
Well, I can now. Here we are. Here we are. Okay, and play.
And this is like a scrapbook, basically, is what the book should be.
Exactly. Basically, that's what all this is.
Now let me go back. Right here. Okay.
Many assassinations. Shh. April 1865, Queen Victoria sends Pike two coded missives. The first is received, contains information regarding New World treasure, the City of Gold.
Wait, the Queen wanted to help the Confederacy?
Well, divided America would have been weaker.
And they needed cotton from the South. The second missive was thought to contain a paper cipher suggesting contact with La Vallée, who will hide clues before his death. That's the cipher that was written into the Booth diary page that Thomas tried to burn.
When we had.
Exactly. 1880. Resolute Desk arrives in Washington, sent by Queen to President Hayes.
Missing plank from the White House. Wow.
Here's the final entry by President Coolidge. 1924. I found a plank in secret desk compartment. Plank photographed and then destroyed. Borglum commissioned to destroy landmarks in sacred Black Hills Mountains.
Borglum? Mount Rushmore?
Okay. Did anybody notice something there? Something fishy? Okay. Look at this. What? Before he was reading it and it was done with a chisel point pen, and then when he looked up and looked back down, it was done with a pointed pen. What? Nobody noticed? I know. I just can't see you, but I know that you're all up in arms. You're all up in arms, aren't you? You're all going like this. Oh, I noticed that. I'll go back. Now watch. Now you're going to go, oh yeah, I noticed that.
Scary assassination. April 1865, Queen Victoria sends two coded missives. The first is received, contains information regarding New World treasure, the City of Gold.
Wait, the Queen wanted to help the Confederacy?
Well, divided America would have been weaker.
And they needed cotton from the South. The second missive was thought to contain a paper cipher suggesting contact with right? Bob, who will hide clues before his death. That's the cycle.
So what happened is that first page was the dummy page. And I happened to be at Peter and Sherry Thornton's house with Carrie E. Mai. And they sent me a message and said, you know, they needed that page rewritten. And so they sent me the paper and stuff, and I rewrote it while I was there, sent it back. And they were supposed to film it from the beginning to the end. And they only did the second part. So it's half the dummy page and half my writing. Oh my God, I looked at, that was like seeing the one where I misspelled the word, and I'm going, oh my God, what? But so far, most people have not, you know, gone running in the streets, you know, saying the house is on fire because of that. So, but that was so sad. And the very idea that I'd, you know, gone to such trouble to fix that. But, and then I had written all these stories and stuff for like, really, I think 15 different presidents, and they only showed that those three presidents, Washington, Coolidge, and something else, I don't know. But look at the difference. Okay, then the next one was,
I beg your pardon, sir, but
the map.
I know what a huge,
so that's Arch's text load.
I thought you might want to take a look at this. Have a look at that.
This is a map of Mount Vernon drawn by George Washington himself.
Mr. President, that is exactly what it is. And we're standing right here, sir. This line is an underground tunnel, an escape route that was never found.
I wonder if it's still there. Well, according to this map, it should be plus one, two in here. Yeah, it should be in here.
Yeah.
You ships. That's the mark of George Washington.
Only it's slightly different. These axes, the angles off, for it to correspond with the ones on the map, should form the perfect V. Okay, what else?
The arrowhead.
So we try really hard to get these, you know, authentic and stuff, and they had three other artists make maps and they weren't quite happy with them. So I was really pleased that they liked that map, and, you know, you rough it up and stuff. So I think that was the last of the ones for, and it was supposed to be Mount Vernon that, and George Washington was supposed to have drawn it. So with walnut ink and, Arch's text wove.
DeAnn, I just wanted to point out that we're approaching an hour.
Okay, I'm pretty near done.
Thank you.
And then we'll take questions. And then here's a few more. Let me say a little something about this project. It was Kimberly Elise in the middle had asked me, all of the actresses from this movie, colored girls, had written a letter for Tyler Perry and the author of the movie and the book. And the girls didn't have a name, they had a color. And so I did an illuminated modern letter for the first letter of the letter. And then wrote the rest of it in italic, and it had gold leaf. No, it had, I think it was just gold gouache, but they turned out beautiful. And, you know, I took pictures, and for some reason, the pictures didn't turn out very well. They were very pixely, and I didn't make Xerox copies of them for some reason. I don't remember what, but I'm really sorry about that, you know. I have to be more careful about taking really good pictures and making copies of things, but they loved it, and he really loved it, and they had somebody else make the book out of it, but that was a project that turned out really pretty, really nice. And then for Mad Men, this is a lesson, you know, and I think people should get this, that, you know, they wanted a note where they've dashed it off for somebody. And I dashed off all these different notes for them to use. And then in the end, they used type, you know, and I'm going, type? You don't think your audience isn't sophisticated enough to know the difference between handwriting and type? Come on, you know? So I've noticed that with a lot of things lately, that they'll show on TV or something and it's supposed to be handwriting and it's type. I mean, that's so lame. And then these are just some other TV things that show up year after year. This one's hysterical. Now, if you guys have not seen Seven Psychopaths, it sounds ridiculous, but it is really funny. And it's the same director as the one that this year that won some awards, the Banshees of Inisherin, Martin McDonough. And so I did this in 2011. And it was really, really hard to do. And I just had to write like a psychopath in this diary. And it's hard. We've worked 40 years to do beautiful writing, haven't we? And it's really hard to write like a psychopath. So I worked really hard on this. And in the middle, I'm up in the hills by Dodger Stadium where they're filming. And I keep showing it to the art director, and not the art director, the prop master. And he shows it to the director, and the director says, it's not psycho enough. And you got to write more psycho stuff in it. And I'm going, I'm a 60-year-old cracker. I mean, you know, I can't write too psycho. So I start writing some pretty bad stuff, you know, and I'm hoping nobody ever reads it. And then I get a phone call that my daughter's going into labor with my only granddaughter. And now I better start producing because I gotta go. And Christopher Walken walks in the room and sits down and is having lunch, you know, on the couch. And me and the guy who's doing the illustrations, we're going, oh, cool, you know. But now I gotta try and keep writing psycho, and it's not going very well. And it's November 11/11. And I remember that because that's the day my granddaughter was born. She was born 11/11/11. And so I'm trying to write in this diary. And it was crazy. Sam Rockwell was the crazy psycho. And now I want you to listen, pay attention to what, this is Colin Farrell, but pay attention to what they're saying, because it's really funny. I wrote that on the front there.
Monday the 14th. Sat watching the shadow of the neighbor's flagpole across my lawn again from 7 in the morning to 7 in the evening. That's 11 hours. They've got a right to fly a flag, don't they? Note to self, do not set fire to the neighbor's flag.
you have to watch. It's funny. It's a good one. So anyway, I was able to leave, but he showed the book to the director finally, and he said, he came back and he said, it's good enough, but the director doesn't want to meet you. That meant that he thought I was deranged after he saw the stuff that I wrote in there. But before that, the art director came in because they had written a front page article about me in the LA Times. And the art director said, oh, you know, my father and brother have tried calligraphy and it's really hard. He says, as a matter of fact, they just wrote something in the LA Times about a calligrapher. And then he looked at me, he goes, that was you, wasn't it? And he goes, you're a rock star. I thought, oh my God, I can die today, because that was just the best compliment I've ever had. So I'm telling you, it's been fun here in LA. I mean, you know, it's fun anywhere, but it really has been a hoot over here. So I'm just about finished. Here's where it was a hoot too, because I went to, with my daughter and my granddaughter, to the Ronald Reagan Library for Disney exhibit. And we were just going around the corner. I mean, it had Mary Poppins and Darby O'Gill and the Little People. You know, we love Disney. And we walked into the room, and oh my God, this whole room was filled with all of my artwork, with the Book of Secrets and John Wilkes Booth diary. And all of a sudden, I was a rock star to my daughter and my granddaughter, because, you know, before that, my family doesn't pay that much attention to anything that I do. But now that I'm a Disney star, they went, "What is your stuff doing in here?" And I said, "Well, I guess I kind of forgot that it's a Disney movie." And there, all my stuff was right there in the Disney exhibit. So I was a rock star to my family. And then I just, I'll just go to this one. Just recently, I just did this for a movie that's an Amblin that'll be coming out sometime in the future. And it's the captain's log for, I think, the last voyage of the Demeter. And it's a devil thing too. And so they need this ink on this to bleed, but they needed it to bleed, but they also need it to be able to be read. And luckily, my guy sent me a picture of them filming, doing the filming of it. So I thought you'd enjoy this. So here, I think, there. So you can watch how they do okay. this. And then this is the end.
Right.
So I did many, 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 many of these, 25, 30 of two different pages, so that they can experiment on them. That's once I got the right formula.
Chris, you tell me. Umbrella. And tilt.
So see, it needed to bleed, but not bleed so much that you couldn't read it.
And cut.
So I had to mix Higgins Eternal and Moon Palace ink. So it both bled, but it also stayed put. So, and then get the script right and all that kind of stuff. But that was fun. And then just this last month, we did a bunch of stuff for the White House. Well, it's a Netflix thing about the White House. So we did all kinds of things for, let's see, I'll show you. The White House. So that was fun. And Rick Paulus helped us a great deal on that one.
Did you want me to stop your share screen, Deanne? I mean, you're...
No, we're good. So now we're done. And if you have questions or if we're out of time.
I think we can have a few questions. Several people asked in the chat, did you do the illustrations and the text?
No. I just did the text.
So everybody, if you have questions, why don't you unmute yourself and ask? I'm sure, wasn't this wonderful? Wasn't this so interesting? And it was actually kind of like opening a magic book to see behind the scenes how you did this. Lots of people said, Deanne, that you are a rock star.
Yay!
And always have been.
I'll tell my husband you said that.
Okay, folks, do you have questions? I don't see anybody. I don't see any more questions, DeAnn.
Okay. Well, you know, I love all of you so much, and you're always welcome to ask me questions, because I know a lot of you get these sort of jobs and you're not quite sure what to do about them. I'm not very good at pricing. I know a lot of you have asked me about pricing. I'm pretty terrible at that. So, you know, you can ask me, but I'm not very good at that. But I'm very good at the technical part. Well, on how to do stuff.
You showed us something.
You're more than welcome to always ask me, and I'll help.
Rick Paulus said this was great, DeAnn.
Wendy Trout asked,
"Hi, Rick.
Did you get a credit line in the movie?"
Never. And I should have in National Treasure. He just forgot, but I never get credit.
So I just want to remind everybody that Friends of Calligraphy has a regular lecture series, and we're going to be continue to have lectures for the rest of this year and into next year. As long as we can find wonderful people like DeAnn to talk to us about their process and their art.
And Evelyn, also, we've recorded it and we'll be sending out the link.
Thank you.
Great.
Barbara DeMaria.
I do have a question that is not a Calligraphic question. I'd like to know, last November, when your granddaughter turned 11, what kind of celebration did you have, since her birth date was 11-11-11?
And she isn't that 11. A kick? Yeah, her mom took 11 friends to some sort of party that they had out in Calabasas. Yeah, we always get the biggest kick out of that. And she was born at 11:28.
Thank you.
I want to thank you all so much for coming. And I'm so happy to share whatever fun things that I've done with in the movie industry. But also, I'm a calligraphy teacher, and I'm happy to share any of my classes with you too. So keep that in mind. I'm always I'm always teaching classes.
That's good. I have students too, and some of them showed up today. So I'm very happy to see them.
So, DeAnn, why don't you say how people can find out about your classes?
Oh, it's, I think mostly just Google, and because I have a website, but it's never up to date. Mostly I advertise them on Facebook and Instagram, and then that's mostly how I advertise them.
We have a question. Do you teach online for out-of-town people?
Uh-huh. Yeah. I have a regular Monday 12 to 2 class all the time. I have that ongoing.
And is that in person or online?
Online, a Zoom. Mm-hmm.
If you Google DeAnn Singh Calligraphy, you can find DeAnn's website and the information about her classes also. Mm-hmm. Well, if nobody else has questions, I think we can.
I have a question. Does it can in for your classes? Do you just join at any level? I mean, yes. I'm a real beginner.
Yeah, you can join at any level.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah, it was very interesting. Thank you so much for sharing.
My pleasure.
I had something I would love to say to DeAnn.
Barbara!
It's Barbara, hi, sweetheart. I was thinking that I would like to tell the person you referred to as my nephew,
uh-huh.
What a world we rot. I absolutely am blown away with all that's unfolded since that early beginning.
I know, you're the one who started that.
Well, I can't believe where you took it.
Well,
it's thrilling and I'm so happy for you.
It's my pleasure and you know, you're my girl.
And I feel the same way about you.
Yeah.
It was just thrilling to hear all your adventures.
Hope to see you soon.
I feel the same way. Take good care.
Thank you. Okay. There we go, Evelyn. I guess we can.
Okay. Thank you. Nancy, I think we can quit recording and
stop the recording. Thank you.
And end the meeting. Thank you.